song I have just sung was translated into Kikongo, which is my mother tongue, by Tata Ngila Enoch Wamba, who happened to be the father of Professor Wamba. To the family, I would like to say that you have lost a member of a family who is very important. The only thing I would tell you is that you stick together as a family. That's the only way the healing will come to you. Some of us have gone through it, so we are talking from experience. That togetherness will make you heal. It takes time, and it will never be the same again without him. But the Lord who has created you, who has decided to take Mutawamba away from you, will still strengthen you. I'm going to leave you with just two verses from the Bible, because for me, without the Bible, I would not have the strength which I can talk about today. The Bible gives me that strength day and night. There's a verse in Isaiah chapter 40, the last verse, that's 31, which says, "But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." The second verse I would like to read is in Isaiah 41, verse 10. It gives me strength day and night. And it says, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." I cannot be talking to you if the word of God has not been at my heart.
Welcome to the celebration of life for Professor Wamba Diawamba. Today, there are many communities throughout Africa and the world that believe that one soul wanders the earth for 40 days, often coming back home, visiting places that brought joy or even sorrow, and noting those people still in need of comforting. It is the living who gather to remember the departed, perhaps visit the grave, or have a final meal together while sharing fond memories. It is a time to comfort the living and to be reminded of the brevity of this life. For some, after the 40th day, the living can no longer grieve about the departed. They must move on with their lives. Today is for the living. It is for Elaine Wamba, her sons, and all other family members. We cannot expect them to no longer grieve and simply move on with their lives. What we can do is share our love and our support so that they continue to make this journey from pain and grief to understanding and acceptance. Today is to make the journey that Ernest Bazunini Wamba Diawamba may have made over the last 40 days with family, friends, and colleagues sharing with us. We will share memories of him as a philosopher, teacher, Pan-African activist, and seeker of peace and justice, especially through his ideas on emancipatory politics and the importance of the spiritual well-being of all human beings. Today is for his friends and colleagues to affirm that Professor Wamba's life had meaning for them as his students and mentees, colleagues and co-authors, and as a politician and liberation fighter. Whether in a U.S. university, the University of Dar es Salaam, or various settings in urban and smaller communities throughout the world, Professor Wamba was able to succinctly connect the dots between theory and practice. His arrest in 1981 by the Mobutu regime ignited a Free Wamba campaign that not only ensured an early release, but highlighted the false narratives generated by the political leadership of then Zaire. He was not deterred by his arrest, however, and continued to seek freedom and justice for the people of the Congo through various involvement in Congolese, regional, and imperial politics. While we have come to pay our respects to Wamba, we should not be remiss not to also honor the former president of Tanzania, Mwalimu Julius Nyerere. He consistently affirmed Professor Wamba's instincts through political and professional support. With Professor's employment at the University of Dar es Salaam, his activities participating in the University of Dar es Salaam staff assembly led to him also playing a key role on the African front of intellectual ballot of African battles and social involvements with the Council for the Development of Social Science Research, or CADESRA, based in Dar es Salaam. Today, the global Pan-African movement comes together, hosted by the Pan-African Congress North American delegation, to honor a man, a husband, a father, brother, uncle, social theorist, liberation fighter, professor, and author. We have come together to acknowledge that we are the people who need comforting, and these are the memories that bring us comfort. For those of you who would like to share your memories, please place them in the chat room, and we will try to read as many of them as possible at the conclusion of the program. I will now hand over to Kioko Omosa, who will take us through the prepared program.
Thank you. At this time, I would like to take the opportunity to share some of my favorite memories of my father. One thing I remember especially was how gifted he was at storytelling. And he seemed to know literally dozens, if not dozens of dozens. As might be expected from a historian of his caliber, some of the stories were simply his own historical accounts of events that he had actually witnessed in his own village as he was growing up. For example, he used to tell us of a sleepwalking uncle who one morning awoke to find himself perched among the branches of a 20-foot palm tree, very much to his absolute horror and with no earthly idea how he got there. Other stories were pure fantasy, traditional folk tales from his village. They had talking gazelles, dancing ghosts, intellectual honeybees, and immortal dogs. There was many an evening where he would share these with my siblings and I, and we would surround him mesmerized, hanging on his every word. One of my favorites from this category was about a clever toad who had hand-carved a magic whistle that the other animals tried unsuccessfully to steal from him. Then there were the tall tales, the stories about people, places, and things that actually existed, but were so embellished that there's no way they could have actually happened as recounted. These stories were my personal favorites, precisely because of how absurd they often were. When my father and his university colleagues would get together, they would trade such tales, each trying to outdo the other by telling the tale that was the most extreme. There was one story of my dad's from one of these sessions that basically won the evening that I remember vividly. It was about a man from my father's village who had a particular birth defect that caused him to be born missing a bone in each of his forearms. As my father claimed, people with this deformity are by no means physically challenged. In fact, according to my dad, it is quite the opposite. People such as this fellow from my father's village would typically develop superhuman strength as adults. As the story goes, this gentleman was owed money by someone who tried to escape by catching a train to Matadi, but he was unable to get away because his debtor had grabbed a hold of the train and was using his incredible strength to keep the train from leaving the station. My father also told us about how, on a different occasion, this same man hunted and killed a Cape buffalo with his bare hands, and then lifted the dead animal by himself and carried its 2,000-pound carcass back to his home on foot. There were literally dozens more stories like this, and I could go on and on. But for now, suffice it to say that his survivors, which is to say his friends, colleagues...
Initially, the philosophy club, which was the chair of, you know, like the founder and inspirator of. And, you know, the philosophy club at that time was the only space at the University of Islam where you could engage in philosophical issues autonomously, because philosophers at the University of Islam didn't have a department. There was no department of philosophy. And for a long time, philosophy was only taught as part of development studies or education or political science. So Professor Wamba, dear Wamba, inspired this idea of having a philosophy club where philosophy is engaged in autonomously and not as part of some other subject. That was my introduction, first introduction to Professor Wamba. And then as I got to know him and his wife, Elaine, he just was such a simple person. I mean, you had read about him, you had heard about him. I mean, when he was speaking, when he was at home, I mean, when he was with you, he didn't give you the impression that he was this huge, gigantic person that you had heard about, you know, or that you read about. It was so simple, you know, down to earth. And so, although I knew him at the University of Islam as the chair of the philosophy club, and we, you know, he used to always introduce all these tons of people who came to give talks at this, you know, seminar room two, seminar room four. I mean, those who have been to invest of that, some, you know, those seminars. And, you know, so he represented philosophy, you know. But of course, then, you know, later on introduced us to great African philosophers. And in all the philosophical debates, in the philosopher world. But that was one Professor Wamba, the philosopher. But he was also a politician. And on this, I would want to say, when he was the leader of the RCD in Congo, a lot of his academic colleagues were a little bit upset. But what was this professor doing with these bourgeois characters in the Congo? You know, I mean, you know what? You know, so again, he was a philosopher and academician who was prepared to, you know, death in his hands, you know, I mean, engaging in politics with all these market, crazy people, who he had to work with, who sometimes, of course, you know, did him harm. And then finally, there was the philosopher, the Professor Wamba, in his home, where most of the time he ate natural food. He introduced me to the idea of natural food, you know, eating, grass, groundnuts in the raw, and all kinds of, interesting things. And then he was at home. He was a father, a companion to Elaine, a father to his, children, and we were, wherever I went there would be food. So, that was Professor Wamba to me, an academician who was very simple, very humble, but who was very, very deep with regard to philosophy. History for him was part of this. With Pan-Africanism, starting with Africa everywhere. Even in philosophy, it starts with Africa. Even with Marxism, it starts with Africa. You know, he wasn't one of these people who would read texts and then not remember that, our old sages, Africa knew all these things, So I will only say that for those of us who remember Professor Wamba, we remember him for Africa, we remember him for marrying politics and academics, for marrying Marxism with Pan-Africanism, for being a simple person, for being a man, a father, and a companion to his great friend Elaine, and demonstrating that one can be men of all those things and be those things with humility. That was Professor Ernest Wamba Dia Wamba, always known to everyone as Ernest.
Professor Wamba Dia Wamba, for many years, because we worked together at the University of Dar es Salaam, and I will always remember him as a quiet, unassuming, but very intellectually sound scholar. I recall many times in conferences when I would see Professor Wamba sitting quietly and listening to the rest of us, listening to his colleagues, giving their viewpoints, different scholarly viewpoints, many times with a lot of pomp or even arrogance at times and in loud voices. And then when it came to his turn, in a soft voice, but always with a smile on his face, he would bombard us with such intellectual and scholarly knowledge, which left all of us stunned. And he would still remain extremely calm. But I would also like to say that for the many years that I knew Professor Wamba at the University of Dar es Salaam, I never really realized how deeply committed he was to the liberation of his country, the Democratic Republic of Congo until the time that he quit his job as professor to go to the DRC and fight for his country. I was the deputy vice chancellor at that time, in charge of academic affairs, and I know for sure that Professor Wamba's urge and commitment to liberate his country, it was so strong that he actually either forgot, or he did not bother, or he forgot to even ask for permission to leave the university to go to the DRC. So he actually simply quit his job and left for the DRC. For me, that really sent a note that Professor Wamba was deeply, deeply committed to the liberation of his country. And in a way, I'm so glad that his life, end of his life, also happened in the country that he loved so much. Even though we would have loved to accord him our last respect here in Tanzania, where he lived in many countries, but I think DRC needed to pay the last tribute to this great man of that country, but also of Africa. Professor Wamba will be deeply missed in the intellectual circles. Will always benefit from his great work that he has done, and this will remain a long-term legacy. But all I want to say to end is I pray to God that he rests in eternal peace. Thank you very much.
Valentina Chiquita la noche, Valentina Chiquita la noche, aye mama, aye mama, Valentina Chiquita la noche, Valentina Chiquita la noche, Valentina Chiquita la noche, aye mama, aye mama. Valentina, aya noche, Valentina, aya noche,
ege mio, mi Valentina, oye oya,
Valentina, aya noche,
o mi linguma, mi Valentina, oye oya,
Valentina, aya noche.
Panda en la costura. También se supo que andaba con Gonzalo. No eres boba, niña. Exacto.
I knew Professor Ernest Wamba Diawamba for quite some time, for many years, I should say. Initially in the 1980s as a student of his at the University of Dar es Salaam in Tanzania, and eventually as a colleague and friend in the same university, specifically in the Department of History. And even after Wamba Diawamba left the university to pursue his other interests elsewhere, I maintained occasional contact with him. And I should say, I feel greatly privileged to have interacted with him quite intensely at times. And so I have good memories of Wamba Diawamba. I remember him more intensely as a passionate friend, a passionate person, a passionate intellectual. He had great passion for human beings, great passion for human experiences in history. And he had great passion for the future of Africa. He always reflected on how what Africa passed through, the miseries that African people went through, and what could have been done to overcome those miseries. He was always very bitter about the bad experiences of African people under slavery and slave trading, bad experiences of African people under colonialism, and bitter experiences of African people now and under the neo-colonial situation. Ernest Wamba de Wamba had a passion for good human life wherever they were, and especially in Africa, as far as he was concerned. He had great passion for debating and bringing up new ideas every time he got an opportunity to do that. He would always bring ideas that some of which were not yet tested. He would tell them to people, and he would discuss those ideas with colleagues and friends in various settings, including academic seminars, and including informal meetings. He was a person of great ideas. He reflected on almost everything in life. He never took anything lightly. He took things seriously. When he saw people dying prematurely, that was a big concern for him. And he always thought that something could have been done to overcome such ugly things happening in our societies. Ernest Wamba de Wamba also reflected on other simple social things, such as good eating, healthy eating. His advice was that people should respect the wisdom of nature in deciding on what to eat and how to prepare food. His advice was always that animals that were meant or created to eat meat, they can eat meat, but those which were created to eat plants should eat plants only. And this was in line with his thinking and his passion for human well-being. He also reflected quite intensely on normal things such as dreams, night dreams, for example. What do dreams mean? And how can they be interpreted? And you know, at times he shared with us his own experimentation with his own dreams and what they meant, and his conclusions. So he was very serious with almost everything. And I also remember Ernest Wamba de Wamba as a highly sociable person. He cherished friendship. He wanted good relationships. And he sometimes made jovial jokes and people enjoyed. He wanted to make people happy. Sometimes he made jokes about his own personal bitter experiences. For example, when he was in the United States, sometimes he was treated racially, in racial discrimination, where sometimes his intellectual capabilities were questioned and he had to work extra hard to prove his intellectual abilities. That was a bitter experience on his part, but he told to us as a nice flowing story. So such was Ernest Wamba de Wamba, a person I remember very dearly, a person whose principles I cherish, and a person whose life I celebrate today.
I did not have the privilege of being a friend, a colleague, or a student of Professor Wamba. But of course, we always hear stories of Wamba de Wamba and his continued active participation in the politics of Congo DRC. I met him only twice, once in the late 2000s at Soma Book Cafe, and he told a story of Black people in Brazil. He's the first person I ever heard talking about Black people in Brazil. And the second time was when we visited him at home last year in Dar es Salaam. And I saw on his bookshelf a book on Eritrea, maybe more than one book. But why do these stories matter of the things that I saw and the things that I heard him say? It's because we tend to fall into the posts that are set by the media, by the publishing industry, by sometimes restricted by our respective imperial histories. Because We now, like right now, we're following about Black people in America, Black Lives Matter movements and protests. But what do we know and how much do we follow about Black lives in the southern half of the Americas? And when I saw Ebuku and Eritrea, it just reminded me that we always refer to the Biafra moment in 1967. We talk about it more often, but hardly do you see people connecting Biafra with Eritrea. So that served for me, both stories, as reminders that as people who engage not only in academic work and scholarship, but people who engage in real struggles and struggles that matter, struggles that are very dear to us, we should always have the responsibility of engaging the past and engaging the multitudes of our realities as much as we want to envision a future. So while the scholarship and the work that Professor Wamba did during his work matters, for me, these two encounters will remain memorable because that question has been formed in my mind. And maybe things that I took for granted, these are who we are. We should always refresh. We should always expand our notions of understanding of what the past is and what the future holds is almost the same thing. The past is as vast as the possibilities of the future, and we're as many as we cannot count. And every story matters. May he rest in power.
Well, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to say a few words about an extraordinary person, a great friend, Wamba, a great intellectual in the real meaning of the term. Wamba was not overbearing at all, or prone to wearing his great knowledge on the lapel of his coat, as some lesser claimants to the title to do often tend to do. He was so modest, almost shy, really, you know. His knowledge on so many subjects was humbling. Yet despite it, when you spoke to him, you know, it was a conversation. And in the conversation, he made you feel like you also knew as much as he did, you know, which of course had the advantage of creating an atmosphere in which you asked intelligent questions, which allowed him to elucidate even more what he was saying, and made you really feel like, yeah, this is a good conversation. This is a great meeting, you know, of minds, so to speak. You learned so much more, and that this is really the mwalimu, you know, in our Swahili, the mwalimu, you know. But mwalimu, who has really even more, you know, in Hosa, the umfundis. Now, umfundis is a teacher, but also a kind of missionary, if you see what I mean, in the best sense of the word, of course. Somebody that was not just passing on a knowledge, but was passing on also a spirit, if you see what I mean. This I found extremely very, very, very beautiful about Wamba. And when I visited, you know, him and Elaine, thinking I'm going. Within, you know. And we, and in a way gave us reference points that, yeah, okay. Okay, fine. Reference points that maybe he didn't have with some other brothers. And I love to speak French also, which was very helpful. Now, I was privileged to work with the government and with government leaders on the liberation issues on Southern Africa, but also on DRC, and went on missions there several times, the 60s and later on. And even the last one we had when we went with the Mwalimu, with Nyerere, to try and get Kabila and Tshisekedi together, we were with him. And Mwalimu gained a lot from Wamba's briefings on these two people, not just those two people, but the background, which was extremely useful. And the same he did with Mr. Mkapa, the president, who was also a friend. And unfortunately, by the way, he also died 9 days after Wamba, you know. So we are all still mourning that. And so it used to be very good for me to sit and listen to him speak to these leaders and to see how helpful he was in making them understand the crisis in DRC, the sources of disunity, you know, based on all these differences among the people of Congo, but exacerbated also by colonialism and bad governance. Now, I know, oh dear, okay, fine.
Africans, please listen to me as Africans, and you non-Africans, listen to me with open mind. Suffer for world, now your fault be that. Me I say, now your fault be that. Suffer for world, now your fault be that. Me I say, now your fault be that. You all to please take your minds out of this musical contraption and put your minds into any goddamn church, any goddamn mosque, any goddamn celestial, including Seraphim and Cherubim. We're all there now. Our minds are in those places. Here we go. Suffer for world.
Amen.
Enjoy for heaven.
Amen.
Christians go the yab.
Amen.
In spiritum heavenus.
Amen.
Muslims go the call.
Amen.
Allahu Akbar.
Amen.
Suffer for world.
Amen.
Enjoy for heaven.
Amen.
Christians go the yab.
Amen.
In spiritum heavenus.
Amen.
Muslims go the call.
Amen.
Allahu Akbar.
Amen.
Open your eye everywhere. Archbishop na miliki, Pope na enjoyment, Imam na gbaladun. Archbishop na miliki, Pope na enjoyment, Imam na gbaladun. Ra 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 ra.
Archbishop enjoy.
I'm Sister Omowale from Berkeley, California, and I'm reading Remembrances of Our Mzee Mwalimu, Professor Ernest Kazu Wamba Diawamba, in Life and in Struggle. In Kiswahili, the standard national language of Tanzania, the nation in East Africa where the Wamba family lives, it is customary in that language to greet all elders, the Wamzee, with the statement of ultimate honor and respect. Shikamu, Mzee, I touch your feet, elder. to which the man or woman being so recognized would respond, "Asante, marahaba." Thank you. Rise and be my equal. Thus today we come to celebrate the life of our international mzee, our mwalimu, teacher, our master, educator, historian, and revolutionary. Professor Ernest Kazu Wamba Dia Wamba, a native son of the Congo, who transitioned from this earthly plane on 12th July 2020, stepped up to meet those in the community of cosmic souls whom we know and love as ancestors, Bankanka in Kikongo, or Egungun in the Yoruba language of Nigeria. Wamba was a true Pan-African liberationist whose practice was grounded in principles that examined Pan-Africanism's flaws as well as its promises, advantages, and benefits. In one of his early writings entitled The Thesis on Pan-Africanism, written for the Spring 1973, Volume 1, Number 2 of the Pan-Africanist Journal, seen here, Wamba criticized and analyzed some of the more demonstrative expressions of African identity while posing the more serious questions about the philosophy's ability to measurably lift African people out from under the colonial yoke of enslaved mentalities into true, active, and quantifiable freedom, that is, being recognized as full human partners in the world's stage of leadership and technology. In a later article entitled Pan-Africanism, Democracy, Social Movements, and Mass Struggles, dated June 1996, in the African Journal of Political Science, which was published by the African Association of Political Science, Armwalimu taught us the importance of critically analyzing the daily realities and policy constructs of each African experience within the context of the repressive democratizing process. He not only taught us, for those of us who were fortunate enough to meet him in the Pan-African Study Group, work with him on the Pan-Africanist Journal, we learned more than discussion and rhetorical debate. Our Mwalimu helped us learn everything about publishing, from column inches to font sizes and styles, time for deadlines, and photo insets, as well as life's puzzles about dialectics, ideologues, and dogmatists. We even learned about the parallelism of African cultural carryovers. For example, the similarities in the musical styles of Papa Wemba, Congolese highlife leader, with that of Machito, salsa king from Cuba and New York. And Wamba loved to dance to both of these styles. Wamba Dia Wamba lived a Pan-Africanist life. Through all of life's wealth of personal and success and academic successes, as well as its pains and tragic heartbreaks, he remained ever serious and steadfast about moving African people to total sovereignty and self-reliance over our lands, our minds, and our souls. So in the words of Sister Asada Shakur, Black Panther Party member from New York in exile, we must carry it on. We will carry it on. We will carry on the legacy and the work of our Mwalimu, Professor Ernest Kazu Wamba Dia Wamba. Amen. Ashe.
Good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever you are. Thank you for the invitation to share some of my memories about the life Professor Ernest Wamba Dia Wamba. What I'm going to do is to focus on one of his essays, Beyond the Elite Politics in Africa, that was published in 1992 in Quest, journal of philosophy discussions that in which he was, in fact, also a member of the editorial board. The reason I chose to do that is in part because, in great part because it contains, it captures the most important aspect of what Ernest kept fighting for throughout his life, and that is pushing and practicing the politics of making sure that everyone in the Congo, from the poorest to the jobless, to the ones that found themselves without, you know, the means of living, to be counted as human beings. So the beyond elite politics deals with what you might call a process of trying to trace how to go from the legacy of a colonial state and the determination of politics through state logic as in fact part of the problem and the reason why one has to fight constantly in order to get out of the state logic, the logic of organizing political parties in order to access power, in order to then, in fact, distribute what is only accessible to the richest people. So, some of the crucial points that I took out from the essay, he points out that the mode of politics that was inherited from the colonial state, and in fact, not just from the colonial state, from enslavement also, has created conditions that, in a sense, have imposed themselves so that instead of people organizing politics in a way that these way of doing politics is emancipative for everybody, in fact, what it does, it reinforces what was inherited from the colonial state. That is to say, doing politics as if the colonial state never ended. The focus, as he wrote, for example, using, in fact, his own words, it's much more important to focus on democratization, that is to say, on the process to get to democracy, rather than on democracy. Because democracy as defined and as inherited from a colonial state was nothing but an imitation of what the colonial state was. A colonial state that in fact was characterized by what it had been, that is to say, the result of conquest, military conquest. And in fact, that is what one can actually see constantly today in African countries. So there is a series of musts that he actually describes, analyzes, move away from territorial nationalism, must move away from developmentalism, must do deconstruction of the colonial state, and must take back control of knowledge process, that is to say, de-hierarchization of knowledge, and really go back to the way of thinking, the way of practicing democracy, as it was done, for example, in Congo culture through the Mbongi, and make sure that the Mbongi is not actually transformed into something that becomes the opposite of what the Mbongi is. So, and that will be what we shall do when we go through these events, and make sure that we are able to carry Ernest's work by creating a virtual universal Mbongi so that we can use that to bring out those results that Professor Wamba had been fighting for all his life.
Oh. Every man got the right to decide. fight this little struggle, 'cause that's the only way we can overcome a little trouble. Brother, our struggle, we come together to overcome the little trouble. Soon we'll find out who is the real revolutionary. 'Cause I don't want my
people to be
contrary. And brother, you're right, you're right, you're right, you're right, you're right. In every manchest there beats a heart. So soon we'll find out who is the real revolutionary. And I don't want my
people to be
tricked by mercenaries. Brother, you're right, you're right, you're right, you're right, you're right. Alright, we'll have to fight.
We gon' fight.
We gonna fight.
We gon' fight.
We'll have to fight.
We gon' fight.
Fighting for our land. We trash it in a Zimbabwe. Mash it up in a Zimbabwe. Set it up in a Zimbabwe. Africans are liberated, Zimbabwe. Africans are liberated, Zimbabwe.
Hello, my name is Patricia Daly. I am Professor of the Human Geography of Africa at the School of Geography and the Environment, University of Oxford. I am honored to present this brief tribute to Ernest Wamba Dia Wamba. I first met Ernest in the mid-1980s when I was doing my PhD research on Burundian refugees in Tanzania, and he was a lecturer at the University of Dar es Salaam. However, my intellectual conversations with him did not really begin until after he had left the university and I was working on my book on gender and genocide in Burundi. Then our conversation centered largely on mobility, identity, and conviviality in pre-colonial Africa. Whilst well-versed in Western philosophy, Wamba's thinking throughout was from the perspective of African ontologies, outside of Euro-American framing of Africans, how they lived their lives in the past and the present. Wamba would recall conversations with the elders in his family about their journeys throughout Central Africa and the deep connections they had with the people and the societies they met before they became fractured by colonial ethnic ordering, proprietorship, and bordering. He got me to conceptualize the existence and potentiality of African space without what he terms the Berlinist African states, to see migration beyond state border and practices. Wamba looked within African societies, on the continent and in the diaspora, for solutions to African problems, because, as he states, their struggles against all forms of slavery and against colonialism have given rise to forms of healing practices and politics and spiritual renewal. He engaged extensively with the teachings of Simon Kibangu, who grew up in a neighborhood close to his home in Sunde Lotete. Dismissing the possibilities of emancipatory politics emerging in contemporary Africa from the state, universities, or even religious institutions, he argues that the thinking about the possibilities of an indigenous social self-transformation or transformation of the DRC must be searched for from elsewhere where people are struggling for survival. Thus, he looked to an Africa rich in cultural and spiritual resources, to indigenous religious movements, the restitution of indigenous community events as providing new spaces for healing of politics and bioethics. Wamba has been a significant influence on my work and will continue to do so as I develop my thinking on mobilities beyond the state. Wamba became a friend. Both him and Elaine always welcome me into their Dar es Salaam home whenever I'm in Tanzania. He will rest in peace with the ancestors because he has always honored them. And in time, his contribution to knowledge as one of Africa's great philosophers and historians will be widely recognized. Thank you.
Well, I still haven't actually come to terms with the fact that I'm not going to see Ernest again. It's actually quite difficult for me. We had developed a relationship whereby we communicated on email regularly. And we talked basically about politics and philosophy and understanding Africa. So not being able to communicate with him is going to be a big gap in my life. But I think I want to say probably two things. One, which is very, very personal, and that was that Ernest was extremely sensitive to supporting me when I experienced death, death of those close to me. I found that an extremely human attribute of his. So he came here in May 2019, and we had long conversations which were recorded. The conversations basically covered his life and his views and his philosophy, his intellectual work, and so on. The recordings were okay, but the transcriptions were not fantastic. I've been working on editing a big part of these now. But anyway, when he came here, I'll come back to this, but when he came here, my partner was very sick with brain cancer. And he was extremely supportive. And he brought her a small token. Anyway, she passed away eventually in October 2019. But what I wanted to say was that his personal sensitivity, his personal behavior and his political views were basically not the same but congruent. They fitted into each other because he cared, and he didn't just care about individuals, he cared about the world in general. So these recordings are being edited. I'm editing them now. It's a lot of work, but I hope they'll be out soon. They're supposed to be published by Tricontinental. And when they are, I will circulate them. I will let people have copies if they're interested. I also wanted to say something regarding Ernest's view of rebirth, because that was central to his philosophy. He actually believed that when someone passed away, they were reborn into someone else. And I think that was very, very important. It was very, very important at a personal level and very important at the intellectual level. What I would like to end with then is to simply say that even though Ernest is gone physically, I believe he could easily be reborn in someone else. And for that purpose, I think what some of us are trying to do is to make his writings available. His friend Eric Kennis is developing an archive of all of Ernest's written work and putting them all in one place. These writings were quite scattered all over the show, but as a first step to making these available to others, we are putting these all in, or he rather, Eric is. I've sent him some stuff which I think I had and he didn't. Eric Kennis is putting everything together, all of Ernest's writing together, in one place online. If anyone is interested in accessing this, it can easily be provided. If you just ask me, or if you don't know Eric's email, just ask me. I'm limited, and I think I've just gone over 5 minutes, so I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Hello, my name is Kioko Mosa, and I'm representing the Friends of Philip Wamba, who was Wamba de Wamba's son. I first learned of Wamba de Wamba when I was a college student at Syracuse University in the mid-1990s, and I was taking an African studies class, and the topic was on African palavras, and I was introduced to Wamba as one of the thought leaders of the African palaver and has a means to conflict resolution. And I was really enthralled at how deeply Wamba Dio Wamba felt in terms of how African states should be organized and his commitment to the democratic process. And in fact, I tried very hard to bring Wamba Dio Wamba as a guest speaker to the campus to speak to our students at the African Students Union. However, that was unsuccessful because he had other commitments. College, I moved to Boston, and I was introduced to Philippe. Because I learned so much about Wamba de Wamba, I quickly became friends with Philippe Wamba, and we had a common kinship based on our, you know, East African and American upbringing. So I was introduced to Philippe's circle of friends, who are also African diasporans living in the Boston area. And we formed a social circle, and we kept meeting frequently, commonly over libations, to talk about Africa and changes we can bring to Africa. We were young, educated, idealistic, and Pan-African, and really felt that However, in 1998, we heard over the news that Wamba de Wamba was actually leading the liberation movement in the DRC. And after we confirmed this with Philippe, we realized that we, as friends of Philippe, could come together and this was an opportunity for us to take and put into practice all of this African political theory that we were discussing over drinks and really support the liberation movement in the Congo. So we quickly put together for Wamba Diawamba to come to the States on a speaking tour to galvanize support for the liberation movement in the DRC. It was so great that I had some, one time with him, and the first time I met up with Wamba Diawamba, he greeted me warmly in Kiswahili and thanked me for all the work that I was doing to support the liberation movement. In my head, I'd created this, larger than life African revolutionary. And when I first met him, he was very humble and, very, he didn't seem like that image that I'd created in my head. However, we did organize for him to speak with a couple of the local colleges here, and what I found that he was able to engage the audience of both supporters and detractors as well. He was very even keeled throughout. His temperament was even keeled throughout the tour that he was here. One of the things that really struck me, and after organizing this and coming back to his hotel room to debrief at the end of this at the end of the whirlwind tour, we asked him, were we successful in the desired outcome? And he said, absolutely. We had given him the opportunity to take his message beyond the Congo and get the support of friends and people in the United States to garner awareness about the liberation movement. And just before he went to sleep, I remember him reaching over to a box of almonds, and he looked me straight in the eye and he said, "Hey, Kyoko, do you know why I have almonds next to me all the time?" And said, "Well, I didn't really know." And he said, "This is a natural sleep aid." And that's something that's always stuck to me. And as soon as he said that, he lay down, closed his eyes and went to sleep. And I remember thinking to myself, wow, this is, with everything that's happened, this is how revolutionaries actually fall asleep. It's with almonds. So that's one of the things I'll always take with me. I've kept it in my memory, and I will truly miss him and miss all of the work that he was able to do for the Congo.
Ernest Banzunini Wamba Diawamba was born on April 16, 1942, to Enoch Ngila Yabwasa Wamba and Judith Luezi Wanzeka at the Sungi Lutete Mission in the western part of the then Belgian Congo, now Democratic Republic of Congo. He joined the ancestors on July 15, 2020, while receiving treatment for a bilateral pulmonary embolism at the University Clinic in Kinshasa in the Democratic Republic of Congo. He was assisted by his sister Martine, nieces Frida and Bernadette, nephew Piaget, and a close associate, Jean-Pierre Mayamuna. Known simply as Wamba, he was brother, comrade, philosopher, political theorist and scientist, historian, thinker, dreamer, proud spouse and parent. Lest we forget spouse and parent, of all the roles Wamba fulfilled in life, that son Kolo, that's me, has offered. Among the most consequential ones were those of doting family man, devoted husband, and loving father to me and my dear siblings. In all his endeavors, those of spouse and parent included, Wamba was at once a globalist and a localist. He always thought and acted as if he were everywhere, seeing things through multiple lenses, all the while firmly grounded in his native Bakongo culture. Wamba was nothing if not a good listener, a quality he learned early in life. He was quick with a smile too. He was also and mostly known for his decency and humanity, a person who had a predilection for befriending anyone, regardless of his or her social status, ethnicity, age, or gender. Wamba was an ardent exponent of the view that anyone can learn from anyone. He was firmly opposed to the hierarchization of knowledge, not only in the academy, but also in society as a whole. In particular, he rejected the imposed culture of the dominant political and economic system, such as the one prescribed by the ideology of capitalism, which Wamba saw as incompatible with the needs and aspirations of humanity in and out of Africa. His was a life characterized by an unyielding adherence to an ethics of truth and ethics, which he learned long before encountering the work of Western philosophers like Maurice Merleau-Ponty, Jean-Paul Sartre, and Alain Badiou. A related feature of Wamba's life and extensive body of scholarship was his interest in the Mbongi or palaver. Mbongi is both a place of learning and an institution of governance that deals with functional and structural issues of society, from resolving differences through a consensus-building process, or kinzonzi, crafting or revising guiding principles of customs, or lusansu luansi, delineating rules of law, or mikanu nyansi, discussing trade issues, or mumbungu, to resolving land distribution issues, or nzaku zantoto ansi, etc. Mbongi is also a form of think tank, wherein transcendental topics are discussed, topics such as cosmology, spiritual apprehension of knowledge, or nzavilu zakintebe, concepts of death and reincarnation, or kizingila, etc. These Mbongi methods of resolving issues with a collectivist consensus-building approach of teaching and learning, as well as discussing various topics pertaining to people's lives, constitutes an irrefutable evidence of the historical existence of democratic practices in Africa, long before the Western master narrative has such practices emerging in ancient Greece. Wamba was educated in both Africa and North America. After finishing his secondary education in the Congo, he won a scholarship to study economics and philosophy at Western Michigan University in Kalamazoo, Michigan. At Western Michigan University, he met an African-American fellow student, Elaine Brown, who was involved in the struggle for Black liberation in the United States and who would later become his wife. In 1968, after completing their studies at WMU, Wamba, Elaine, and their first son, Remy, went to the Congo, where he worked at the Congolese Ministry of Social Affairs. The three returned to the United States in 1971 for Wamba to follow graduate studies at the Claremont Graduate School in Claremont, California. Wamba went on to teach at various U.S. institutions of higher learning, including Brandeis, Harvard, and Boston College. In 1980, the family decamped for Tanzania, where Wamba had been offered a job as a professor of history at the University of Dar es Salaam. He would spend the rest of his academic career there. Along the way, he became one of the most notable African intellectuals of the post-colonial era. It is from a measure of his standing in African intellectual circles that he was elected president of CODESRIA, which is the Council for the Development of Social Science Research in Africa. This is the continent's leading think tank, which he was president of between 1992 and 1995. Despite all his achievements, Wamba was studiously devoid of self-conceit and anything smacking of a cult of superiority or personality. He supped with fellow professors and presidents, but as an intellectual, political activist, and human being, his chief concerns were the peasants, from whom he came, and proletarians. As a historian and scholar, he never ceased to remind audiences that while history may be written by historians, history will only be changed by the masses. And unlike many academics, Wamba believed that he had an obligation to participation was met with real threats. Several times he was persecuted for his outspoken opposition to tyranny in any form. As an illustration, Wamba languished in the notorious underground prison of Mobutu Sese Seko for daring to expose the dictator's program of authenticity for the fraud that it was. Like many others, Wamba likely would have died in confinement, but for the intervention of Tanzanian President Julius Nyerere, who managed to get him released and returned to his post at the University of Dar es Salaam. Wamba would live to fight another day, and fight he did. As a political activist, his most daring and dangerous role was his assumption of leadership of the Congolese Rally for Democracy during the Great Congolese Rebellion in 1998 against the regime of Laurent Désiré Kabila, who had succeeded Mobutu. Alas, Wamba's intervention failed to produce the desired result. The democratization of Congolese politics, an outcome that was vehemently opposed by his then state sponsors, the leaders of Rwanda and Uganda. Their opposition to Wamba was also supported by these two regimes' patriots, which were some Western governments and multinational corporations whose aim was to continue pillaging Congolese mineral resources, as they've always done, through a mechanism of client-state relationships. It is also plausible that these two kleptocratic regimes were afraid that Wamba's vision of a democratic Congo would have set in motion a political domino effect for the region as a whole. Even so, Wamba went on to serve as a senator in the Democratic Republic of Congo. Wamba's political activism was a direct outgrowth of his extensive body of scholarship, especially the aspect of his work that centers on the state. It was his conviction that the colonial state needed to be fundamentally transformed, indeed destroyed and remade anew, to be able to serve the interests of the African laboring classes. And it was precisely this failure to transcend the colonial state, Wamba believed, that ultimately explains the murder of Patrice Lumumba, Congo's first post-colonial prime minister, and the crushing of his political project. As a scholar, Wamba also had a keen interest in popular movements, especially those seeking to contest state power. Among such movements, he gave pride of place to the one led by Simon Kimbangu in opposition to Belgian rule during the colonial period. Wamba's study of the Kimbangu movement speaks also to his interest in spirituality. Wamba himself was deeply spiritual, a quality he equated with being human. For him, spirituality is not to be confused with religiosity. Rather, he defined spirituality as a focus on the collective, not on the individual. It commands a rejection of the focus on acquiring material goods, on the culture of accumulation associated with slavery, colonialism, genocide, white supremacy, and capitalism. In short, Wamba saw spirituality as part of the anti-capitalist ethos. Wamba's spirituality was an integral part of his legacy. He would not have seen his physical departure from this world as an end, but rather as a beginning. That is, as the transition of a soul force with the potential to live again through his labor and legacy. Wamba was predeceased by his sons Remy and Philippe and his daughter Judith Luezi. He is survived by wife Elaine, sons Colo, myself, and James, daughter Cornelia, siblings Celine Idunga Banamana, Julien Luzolo Wamba, André Marie Lukondo Wamba, Martin Luvikula Wamba, and André Wamba, as well as numerous grandchildren, nieces, and nephews. Wamba's survivors also include his extended family, comrades and well-wishers in the Democratic Republic of Congo, Tanzania, and the rest of Africa, Europe, the USA, and indeed the world. through us all, Ernest Banzunini Wamba Dia Wamba still lives, big bright smile and all.
Warmest greetings to everyone from me, Elaine Wamba, in Dar es Salaam, Tanzania. I hope that you were all able to follow the entire celebratory memorial for Ernest, my husband of 54 plus years. It wasn't possible for me to participate in it for various reasons, mainly emotional, but I am deeply grateful to the contributors of this event for their decision to put it together. The memorial's organizers support Pan-Africanism to the highest degree, and from our early adult years, both Ernest and I did as well. My identity as a Pan-Africanist came to the fore when I spent my junior year at a French university in the mid-1960s. I met many Francophone African students there who were committed to returning home after their studies to help develop their newly independent countries. And I decided that I should also put my skills to use somewhere in Africa. When I returned to the US to finish my degree, I met Ernest at our university's French club's first meeting. We got married the following year, and after graduation, we went to live and work in his home country, the DRC, for 3 years. After returning to the US for more studies in the 1970s, we left there in 1980 and settled in Dar es Salaam. I can only say that the rest is history. It is my fervent hope that the issues evoked that have been evoked today show Ernest's endeavors and that they will be addressed by those who understand and support what he was about. This will definitely be a very positive contribution to his legacy. Elaine Wamba Diawamba. I'd like to stop now, and as chair of the Pan-African Congress North American delegation, we said that we would take a few minutes to respond or to note any comments in the chat room. But I also need to be guided by my facilitators who let us know how much time we have and what is actually possible to do. But I will look at a few very briefly and start until I am guided otherwise. I have noticed as we've gone through that we have people tuning in from East Africa, West Africa, Europe, and throughout the United States. So I'll just take one or two chats to start with and share them with you briefly. One of the latest was from Madeline Hewitt. She says, here with all of you listening in from Athens, Greece, inspired by your attributes and by your love, sending deep sympathy for Elaine, Kolo, James, and the whole family. We have one that says, please take time to read his autobiography, Profile of Courage. We have one from Mel Foote, Constituency for Africa, that says simply, what a great man and a great legacy. We have one, from Albert Elam, he says, thank you, Kyoko and Mwosa and your team for organizing the celebration and Kolo for making sure the extended family could participate. We all aspire to make a contribution, but you can take great pride in the contributions of Ernest. Again, our prayers are with the Wamba family and we hope to see you at the family reunion of the US branch of the family, Garland. We have a number in French. We have one, Shambi. It says, my condolences to the family, friends, and colleagues. Professor Wamba was a friend of Wa Na Zuoni, an informal network of Tanzania's intellectuals. Next week, we will hold a live Zoom session in Kiswahili to commemorate him and reminisce on his work. More information below. But he doesn't actually note a site, but we'll put it on our website so you can follow up there. One person noted, I think one good and great big thing to come out of the wonderful life of Ernest is praxis. Again, very important to have his writings available. We have one from Jennifer Erie based in Pretoria, formerly of Dar es Salaam. Thanks for the invite to memorialize the great life of Baba Wamba Diawamba. I had the opportunity to be blessed enough to meet and get to know him and his wonderful family when I was living in Dar es Salaam. My sincere condolences to the family, and I will share his memories with Mama Elaine and my friend James. It was so good to see Julia Lynn and Professor Daly today. Big hugs to everyone. May he rest in eternal peace and power. Jennifer Erie. Then one of our speaker, Oswald, thank you, Kyoko, to your team and for organizing the celebration. I am at least connected to the audio part of the Zoom. Again, he was calling in from Dar es Salaam. The music and the pre-recorded messages give food and drink to my mind and soul. Kwaheri Mwalimu, Awangu Mwalimu Wawote. And then we have, I'm having trouble getting the name. We should not assume the masses are dumb. It is a matter of a gap in information and insight. To lead is to educate and empower the masses. This is a quote from Prof. Wamba. This is what has stuck to me from the only private one-on-one conversation I was blessed enough to have had with Professor Wamba Diawamba. It sticks with me every day. I probably do not even remember it exactly as he articulated it, but if I remember his lesson correctly, the drive it planted in me to ensure everything I do is geared toward empowering me, and this I intend to do and to be able to help forever. Greetings of love to Madame Elaine, Kolo, and Alice, James, and the entire Wamba family from the Eleonora family in Los Angeles, Curacao, the Netherlands. And then okay, Sis Omawali came in, just giving apologies for being late. We saw her pre-recorded presentation. Then there was one from Vivian Morris. Sending much love to Elaine and the Wamba family. Professor Wamba was both my professor and long-term friend. We first connected when I was an undergraduate at Harvard University in the 1970s. He supported and encouraged us as we worked to deepen our understanding of inequalities in the United States and around the world. But even as he helped us delve into the difficulties of addressing injustices, he also showed us the values of humility, tenacity, humor, and family. We have a note from Rupert Lewis, watching from Kingston, Jamaica. Respect to Professor Ernest Wamba Diawamba and his idea of emancipatory politics. Met him in Senegal at a Pan-African meeting. Then this is Theogene Rudasingwa. I met the late Professor Wamba twice, once in USA when I was then Rwanda's ambassador in USA, 1996 to 1999, and again in Rwanda. Apart from sharing the Pan-Africanist idea, I saw in Professor Wamba a wise, calm, collected, and good human being. I deeply respected him. My deepest condolences to you, the family, and friends. We should celebrate and remember the man whose life was put to good use, enlightening others and working for unity, peace, and development in our continent, Africa. Professor Wamba lives behind a powerful legacy. Let us take up the candle. And that is the end of the chat messages. So I'd like to conclude now by saying first.
Sorry, Julia Lynn, there is a message from Ron Bailey. He just posted it from the Afro Studies University of Illinois.
Okay, just a moment. All right, so we have Ron Bailey. I want to thank all of those who have organized this memorial tribute. I want to express my condolences to Elaine and the family. I also want to contribute to the compilation of Wamba's work that was produced with his collaboration, especially a book on the African Renaissance that was to be published by Africa World Press. Aluta Kantanua, Ron Bailey. There was another one for Congolese, don't miss reading Mobutuism after Mobutu of Papa Awamba Diawamba. All right. We'll close the program at this point. And let me say specifically, thank you to all who supported this tribute. It has been recorded, and the recording will be available on our website. And I noted that earlier in the chat room. I'd also like to bring to your attention that the family also has a permanent memorial website, and there is a link if you would like to provide any donations to the family and to provide assistance with the ongoing work. I'd like to say thank you especially to Kyoko Mwosa and Horace Campbell, for your vision and dedication and empathy in organizing and bringing all who needed to be here to the table. I'd like to say thank you to the family for really giving this honor, for allowing us to host this tribute for you. I'd like to say thank you to the panelists for giving some thought to your relationship and for being able to condense it at our insistence to less than 5 minutes. It's clear from hearing what you've had to say that anyone could have gone on for hours, and we have to really follow up with the various programs that the other organizations would like to do, as well as the various written tributes that are to follow. I'd like to say thank you really just to all the participants who took time out of your day to share with us these memories and to perhaps share what happened here today with others through the recording that we have. So I will close now and simply say, Shikamu Imze, Hamba Gahle, Ernest Bazunini, Wamba Diawamba, Lala Salama, Mwalimu.